Is this working now? Yeah, can you hear me? Well, I've just learned one thing, that England's my home country and I don't know how to make a salad. And I'm also a rustic. So thanks, Ken. I've been asked by the organisers, and I would really like to thank the Barilla Centre for Food and Nutrition for inviting me, to particularly address the consumer culture war and how this relates to the future of the Mediterranean model or the Mediterranean diet. But first, you know, I just want to make it clear that I think that the traditional, and that goes back many decades, Mediterranean model to eating could be a potential roadmap towards a different future for our diets and for our food system, not least through creating a model for a sustainable diet. That is, a sustainable diet being one that enables an ecologically integrated food system from production through to consumption. But our current model of the food system is in so many respects still rooted in an old industrial food model and its resulting food culture. If indeed this is still a food culture as defined by shared practices and meanings relating to food. And this food system, as I'm calling it, continues to shape and influence food consumption patterns and hence the food cultures, consumer cultures. So the impact of the Mediterranean model has to be situated within this broader context, which sees today's consumer culture war as a conflict over the future of food consumerism. I would argue that the ongoing industrial food system key dynamic is still consumerism. That is, creating the desire to purchase goods and services in even greater amounts and the sophisticated mechanisms to activate this. In this respect, the industrial production model and its accompanying hugely sophisticated consumer marketing industries are designed to push this particular consumer agenda forward. And so in many respects, this model appears to be the only game in town. But also, we should also give some congratulations to that system, because world population has doubled in the past 50 years, and this system has created our abundant food supply, which we take for granted today. It's now that we're sort of being critical of that particular model. But the ongoing consumerism driving the industrial food system, as we've seen from many of the conference presentations today and yesterday, there is a growing and an increasingly articulate alternative. But this consumer culture food war is really not simply between mainstream and alternatives. Within the mainstream itself, there is a struggle underway to shape consumer culture towards particular interests. So food processors, they work to sell us branded dreams. The caterers lure us with food offerings through strategies that owe more to entertainment industries, a trend in the US called eatertainment. And of course, the supermarkets try to outdo both. A new entry or more recent entry into this food culture melee are some farmers, or perhaps more accurately, agribusiness, who are also attempting to inject their imagery into consumer culture with an appeal to the natural. But increasingly, all of these players attempt to convince us as consumers of their sustainability and environmental credentials. The Mediterranean model is competing with all these and other consumer influences. But while the food consumer culture is important, food consumer culture is really rarely mentioned in relation to nutrition and health policy documents or through investigating food business. Often it is even hard to even find the mention of food culture within food policy and nutrition documents. Rather, modern food and nutrition policy and business language is all about framing consumers as they define them through the lens of consumer choice. Choice is thus the king, the queen, increasingly the little prince and princesses of modern consumerism. So an important task is to reclaim consumer food culture over the dominant narratives of food choice and consumer choice. But we should not underestimate this challenge. In terms of sheer scale, food and beverage industries, the retailers and processors, and their enabling agribusiness partners remain at the cutting edge of this modern day food consumerism, not least in its global aspects. Its core marketing goal, in marketing jargon, is the drive to satisfy consumer needs and wants, but within its own logic of its productionist framing. Now, to illustrate this process, perhaps in an extreme version, there's a recent example of this globalizing consumerism in food with Nestlé's floating supermarket. And there's a picture of it. This is a supermarket boat set up by Nestlé that plies its trade on the Amazon River. It made its maiden voyage last year and continues selling products to isolated riverside people along the Amazon. The boat carries around 300 branded processed lines such as ice cream and infant milk. And the sort of logo of the boat is, "Here comes Nestlé." Too true. But being charitable, we might actually see trends such as this as a modernizing tendency in food. But it's a long way from encouraging or developing a culturally specific Amazonian food system. So while the Nestlé's Amazon floating supermarket might be an extreme example of consumerism, it is relevant because it's an illustration of the forces arrayed against long-established food cultures, especially if food cultures are defined through their relationship to nature. And this, in my view, is especially important in the case of the heritage of the Mediterranean model and its close ties with its particular environments. But even at a simpler level, the Mediterranean model is under threat in relation to the industrially driven production and food consumer system. It is a diet, as we well know, largely established on plant-based foods with little meat and dairy. And this is almost the opposite to the modernizing trends in global food markets, which are seeing the increasing promotion of meat and dairy products. But in another way, the modern global consumer culture offers possibilities for the Mediterranean model. In a globalizing world, cuisines have opened up or been created new consumer markets and introduced new eating possibilities for people today that were unheard of to past generations. For example, in my own home country, England, we are no longer a nation that tucks into fish and chips as our national dish. But these days, we much prefer chicken tikka masala. And there's a good example of it. And in Germany, so I'm told that the most popular fast food now is Doner Kebab. In this manner, the modern globalizing food system relies as much on breaking down and reinventing food consumer cultures as it does in breaking down the chemical and nutrient components of foodstuffs and ingredients and reassembling them into branded food products, complete with their new marketing, stories about their naturalness and healthiness and provenance. But also importantly, from the Mediterranean consumer culture perspective, the Mediterranean countries themselves, with the European ones, have started to succumb to these globalizing and industrializing tendencies. So as a result, we can see that Mediterranean countries in Europe have become, the diet has become much higher in both sugars and fat, and childhood obesity rates, not adult childhood, are now higher in some Mediterranean countries than compared to Northern Europe. A study published in 2009 by Da Silva and his colleagues looked at the Mediterranean Adequacy Index among 41 countries, studying these countries between the early 1960s and the early 2000s. And in this study of 41 countries, they showed that the majority had started to drift away from Mediterranean-like dietary patterns. But the most striking result from this study was the European group of Mediterranean countries that experienced the greatest decrease in their Mediterranean adequacy index. In other words, they showed the greatest move away from the traditional Mediterranean diet. And in particular, there's a great increase in sugar, meat, and edible oils other than olive oil. And another key tactic in the consumer culture war has been the skill with which industrial food system has been able to break the bonds of nature between production and consumption in the name of consumerism. So that today, often consumers no longer even know where their food comes from or even what it is they're really consuming. So the Mediterranean diet has to confront its own identity and tradition and retell an authentic story for today's consumer, struggling to peel off their food consumer skin and reconnect with their food and ecological citizenship. In this respect, consumers are looking to reconnect with their food and their food cultures. And by reconnection, I mean to bring together different elements of the food system, that is producers, consumers, market, knowledge, and nature. However, in the consumer culture war, reconnecting in this sense appears to be especially challenging, as I'd like to illustrate through focusing briefly on a case study of the European olive oil system. That's Italian olive oil, by the way. For this case study, I draw upon a paper published only this year by two Austrian researchers called Schneider and Kraussmann, who have written a detailed case study of the European olive oil system and its impact on land use. Their case study, which they looked at data from the early 70s, over three decades, from the early 70s to the early 2000s, they show how olive oil developed from a niche product that could hardly be found in food stores outside of the producing regions towards an integrated component in the diets of industrial countries. They discuss the impacts of the promotion of the healthy Mediterranean diet on land use and agroecosystems in the producing countries. For the purposes of this presentation, I'm just going to simplify one or two of their key findings. But first, some background. Altogether, they looked at 15 European countries. They looked at five producing countries, which are Spain, Italy, Greece, Portugal, and France, and 10 non-producing European countries: Austria, Belgium, Denmark, Finland, Germany, Ireland, Luxembourg, the Netherlands, Sweden, and the UK. In terms of the global market for olive oil production, olive oil is still concentrated in the Mediterranean region. And in this respect, three countries, Greece, Italy, and Spain, dominate. It's also important for the rural economy. The olive oil sector in Europe has more than 2.5 million producers, or roughly a third of all of those 15 European country farmers. And in particular, Spain has emerged as the country with the largest olive oil area and production. And this is particularly concentrated in one particular area of Spain, namely Andalusia. So over this period of three decades, production and consumption of olive oil almost doubled in these European countries. And together, these 15 countries, they were responsible for 79% of global olive oil production and 70% of consumption. However, production and consumption are very strongly related. Spain, Italy, and Greece, who together consume roughly 86% of olive oil production, while Portugal and France consume 8%, whereas the non-producing countries altogether, the remaining 10, ended up with around 6% of total olive oil supply. But we also have to see the market for olive oil in these countries in the context of all edible oils, because olive oils increasingly have to compete in a global market with other edible oils. So even though in these producing countries olive oil is an important component of consumption, it still now only accounts for around 40% of total edible oil consumption. And consumption is still dependent on these distinct regional geographies, with producing countries having high levels of consumption. For example, Greece consumes on average 20 litres per person per year of olive oil. And that's compared to an average, this is an average across all the 10 non-producing EU countries, of 0.6 litres, that's 0.6 litres per person per year. But even this is a tenfold increase in those non-producing countries over the 30-year period that Schneedel and Krausman examined. But what are some of the consequences of these production and consumption changes? First is the impact on local and traditional olive groves. Many of these have been abandoned, and modern intensive monocultural production plantations have been set up, which rely upon irrigation systems, agrochemicals, and mechanizations. This has enabled a much higher productivity, but has also meant major structural changes in land use. And in their paper, it's gone. Do you know where my next slide's gone? It's just gone. I didn't even think of that, yeah. No, it wasn't a joke. It was a serious point I was going to make. Yeah. Anyway, the point is, I was going to show from the paper how the landscape has been transformed in a particular area of Andalusia, and you can see how traditional agricultural practices and land use has completely transformed, and now it's just covered from a satellite photo with just a series of black dots, which are basically each black dot being an olive tree. And Schneidel and Kreuzmann, they write, while traditionally fed olive trees have grown mainly on marginal soils, industrial olive groves have expanded majorly into agricultural land with high quality soils, and this has led to a structural transformation of the Mediterranean landscapes. It's also important to note that as well as these production changes, consumer culture has actually been shaped by these, through to the active marketing of the healthy Mediterranean diet, which has looked to boost consumption of olive oil. And promotion sort of strategies were designed by subsidies from the European Union and through its common agricultural policy, by national food trade promotion organizations and producer bodies, and such as the International Olive Oil Council. In other words, consumption and the culture of the healthy Mediterranean diet and olive oil was as much influenced and driven by production interests as well as perhaps consumers looking for dietary change. In fact, Schneidel's and Kreuzmann's own conclusion is that in their case of olive oil, supply has driven demand more than consumption. And also the case of olive oil in this sort of period under study show in relation to consumer culture war and food system also serves as a lesson of how difficult it is for consumers in a globalized food system to connect to the environmental consequences of their sort of consumption patterns. So just to make a few concluding remarks, we need to understand the food consumer culture war in the context of the industrial food system, because it's only by understanding how food consumer culture has been shaped by supply chain forces that civil society, policymakers, public health educators, or even innovative businesses can hope to create a realistic alternative strategy and response. The Mediterranean model when set in the context of the industrial food consumer culture war, raises many questions about its implementation as a potential new model. From such a perspective, we have to ask, and I think provide answers if we are serious, about what would be the impact of its adaptation on agricultural practices, food economies, consumption patterns, and in addition to potential long-term public health gains. As noted in case of olive oil, some of the downstream production implications may be unexpected and not necessarily desirable over the longer term. And the consumption impact of a healthy oil in relation to public health objectives may remain minimal. So this then raises questions about how to internationalize the Mediterranean model in a culturally appropriate manner, not only for local food systems, but also for global consumers. And I think in this context, I would argue that perhaps one possible bright spot from the current regime of economic austerity hitting European countries, especially in the Mediterranean region, but also countries like my own country, is that the Mediterranean model offers the perfect austerity diet. The Mediterranean model sets out a framework that can provide low-cost and nutritious foods, such as many legumes, vegetables, and fruits. And this diet not only happens to have the potential to be economic, healthy, and sustainable, but enables a wonderful gastronomic possibility and social acceptability. But in the world of food and nutrition policy, there has been a reluctance to confront the true scope of consumer culture. All often consumer culture is framed narrowly as one of choice, and even choice is limited to macroeconomic issues such as price and convenience. Whereas there's a much better, and this is much better understood by food businesses and NGOs than governments, consumer culture and choice itself embraces a much more complex set of demands and aspirations. Increasingly, in food, both health and ecological principles together are key consumer concerns, and a repositioning of an authentic Mediterranean diet seems well placed to reconnect with these aspirations embedded within our consumer culture. So I remain hopeful. Thank you.